On Point is a production of WBUR Boston and NPR.
From WBUR Boston, I'm Tom Ashbrook, and this is On Point. Burmese pythons are fine in Burma. In Florida, they're proving a nightmare. Huge, powerful, hungry, and absolutely taking over the Everglades. Now the invasive apex predator, wiping out whole populations, fundamentally changing the species profile, and just getting started. We've got snakes on the loose and an ecosystem in trouble. This hour on Point, the python takeover of the Florida Everglades. You can join the conversation. Have you seen the python invasion, its consequences? Is there any way to turn it back? We're at 1-800-423-8255. That's 1-800-423-TALK. And you can comment at our website, onpointradio.org, or on Twitter and Facebook at On Point Radio. Encounters with Burmese pythons increasingly common in southern Florida. Here's a little clip from last summer. A farmer outside Miami found a snake that he said was responsible for the disappearance of goats, chickens, house cats. Here's nightly news anchor John Favoli from Miami's NBC affiliate WPTV.
Last Friday, a farmer reported seeing a snake under a trailer. When firefighters arrived, they found this, a Burmese python's 11-foot tail wiggling back and forth. They quickly grabbed it before it could slither away. The venom unit eventually arrived and helped to remove it from the area. The farmer says the Burmese bandit was responsible for eating several of his animals.
The farmer's animal's gone, but many, many more from the wild, from the Everglades themselves. And we're going to hear in this hour from a python hunter and from the Everglades Park Service. But joining me first today from Davidson, North Carolina, is Michael Dorcas, professor of biology at Davidson College. He's author of a new report in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Science titled Severe Mammal Declines Coincide with Proliferation of Invasive Burmese Pythons in Everglades National Park. Michael Dorcas, welcome to On Point. Thanks for being here.
You bet.
We've got a lot of history to look at here and the whole profile of an ecosystem, but just give us some of the numbers, if you would, on the mammal categories that you've tracked and the declines. I mean, we've got 90% plus declines in any number of species. Like what, Michael?
When you compare the 1990s to the 2000s, which is essentially before and after the proliferation of pythons in Everglades National Park, we've documented declines in raccoons of 99%, opossums about the same, declines in bobcats of about 87%, deer of 94%. And then things like rabbits and foxes we haven't seen during our surveys during the 2000s.
Meaning something like 100% gone.
Well, I wouldn't be willing to say they're 100% gone, but certainly during our surveys we didn't detect them.
When you're talking declines of 99.8%, I think was the raccoon number, something like that, or 99.3%.
Right. Uh-huh.
I mean, this is as good as wiped out.
It's a severe decline in the number of raccoons, that's for sure.
And how large a role in these population declines are you attributing to the python?
That's a really good question. Our data are consistent both spatially and temporally with the python as the major cause of these declines. There could be other factors involved, but most of those factors we have no reason to believe are playing a significant role.
I've read you saying that in South Florida, and I guess mainly in the Everglades at this point, you've got thousands, tens of thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of now, I guess, what we'd have to call wild pythons.
You would consider them wild pythons. They're not supposed to be there, but it's, if you find a python in Everglades National Park, chances are it is a wild hatched and living snake there.
People used to think that they couldn't they wouldn't reproduce in Florida outside of captivity. I guess that's pretty fully disproved.
It certainly has been disproved. And I probably would have been one of those people. If you'd told me 15 years ago that we'd have a giant python living in the U.S. and doing well, I probably wouldn't have believed you.
These are an invasive species. How many years has it been since Southern Florida was naturally home to giant snakes like these?
That's a really good question. Based on the fossil evidence, it appears it's been about 15 to 16 million years ago before or since there was a snake that was large enough to eat things like raccoons and adult possums.
That's a long time.
That is a long time.
And here in the space of 10 or 20 years, we've got this population explosion of pythons. And the source of these pythons is, I mean, they're all imported, obviously. This is not Burma we're in, so they all came from somewhere else.
Right, yeah. They're native to southern Asia. They have been a mainstay of the pet industry for decades. In fact, when I was a teenager, I had a pet Burmese python. So they've been very common, and they're nice, gentle snakes under most circumstances when they're bred in captivity. They make good pets, except that, they get really large and they can live for a long time. And so people have problems getting rid of them after a while. So they've become a real problem because they either escape or they're released, in various places. And now they've become, of course, established in Everglades National Park and now well outside of Everglades National Park as well.
I'm reading here that in the wild, Burmese pythons grow to about 12 feet on average. They've had them up to 19 feet long. They can be 150 plus pounds. So this is a very substantial reptile.
It's an impressive snake. Yeah, we've captured snakes approaching 17 feet in Everglades National Park that weigh well over 100 pounds. And just last October, there was a 15-foot snake that was captured north of Everglades National Park that had an adult deer inside of it.
A deer, and not to mention alligators. I mean, they'll actually go after what was the apex predator of the region.
For the most part, these snakes are eating birds and mammals, but there have been several cases of them eating alligators, including relatively large gators, around 6 feet long. They're not going to be able to eat a big adult, 12-foot gator. And actually, there are numerous cases of gators eating pythons as well.
We've got an incredible video at our website of a large python, taking on an alligator in Florida. It's kind of amazing boldness to see their scrap, and it's quite a scrap. Mike, it's been a long time since I was really out in this terrain, but some years ago they opened up alligator hunting again in the Everglades after a long time of it being illegal. And I was down there as a reporter watching people go out and do this, and I'll never forget the abundance of wildlife that we saw out there at night, out in the skiffs, hunting in the Everglades. They pulled in 4 or 5 that night. But, I mean, it was obvious that there was plenty of food supply for these alligators. They were so abundant. And that food supply presumably has been exactly the kind of mammals, in large part, that are being wiped out by the pythons.
Yeah, well, the alligators, especially large alligators, will sometimes take birds and mammals. But actually, the data that we have for alligators in the Everglades is that they eat a lot of things like snakes and turtles as well. So they don't. It's not necessarily that pythons are wiping out food that is essential for gators. There are other things that gators will eat that pythons don't seem to eat.
So the mammals the raccoons that they might grab from the shore are not critical to the alligator survival. So we could end up with what? A lot of alligators and pythons and not so much of a whole lot of other mammals.
Well, I don't know that it'll change alligator numbers or decrease alligator numbers to any degree. We don't have any evidence of that. But that's certainly something that could be looked at over time.
We're going to talk with a python hunter in a few minutes, but is there any way to, once you've got a population like this of these big snakes, tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands, is there any way to clear them out?
That's a really good question, one I'm asked a lot. This is, in nearly all cases with invasive species, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And in this case, because these are snakes, I mean, even though they're large snakes, they're very difficult to find. We can go out and we can find some pythons, but you can't go out and find all the pythons. And especially when you're talking about, a large population that we don't know exactly how many are out there, but we know that there's a lot. And over a vast landscape, much of which is relatively inaccessible to humans, it makes it a really difficult problem to develop methods to even think about suppressing their populations, much less extirpating them.
I don't know if it matters anymore, the incoming imported pythons, but we saw that the federal government last month put the brakes on imports of a few species of big snakes.
Yeah, they did. They used they listed them as injurious species in the Lacey Act, and so they listed 4 species the Burmese python, two African python species that are similar, and then the yellow anaconda. There are a couple others like green anacondas and reticular pythons that actually get larger that were not listed. But that's not going to, in other words,
The barn door is closed too late here. They're already out.
Yeah. I mean, for Everglades National Park, releasing another Burmese python is probably going to have minimal impact on the overall population. But certainly the law may help prevent Burmese pythons from being introduced elsewhere where they might survive, or prevent other species from becoming established in South Florida.
And they're on the move. I'm reading reports here that the pythons have now taken to salt water, and they've apparently even been swimming down into the Keys.
We have, quite a few records from Key Largo of pythons that certainly would have, had to traverse some salt water to get there. And we have, down in southern part of Everglades National Park and the mangrove area, it's pretty much salt water. And we have some of the densest python populations down there. Now, that's not saying a python can survive in salt water for long term, but they certainly seem to be tolerant of salt water for some time that would allow them to live and actually possibly expand their range, by swimming across.
That's southern into the islands. But you've also been thinking about a kind of northern expansion here, that a lot of the American South could, pretty good swath of it, could become home to pythons, northern Florida.
It's hard to know exactly, but there have been numerous climate models that have been used, which essentially take the climate of the snakes and put it onto the U.S., and all of them predict significant parts of the southeastern U.S. as suitable climate for pythons.
Michael Dorcas in Davidson, North Carolina, at Davidson University there. Please stand by. We're talking this hour about Burmese pythons in America and the python takeover of the Florida Everglades. Have you heard the news? Python takeover, the Florida Everglades being stripped of mammals, pythons eating coons and muskrats and bobcats and deer and alligators. Where does this go? 800-423-8255 is our number. 800-423-TALK. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We'll be right back. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We're talking this hour about Burmese pythons, big snakes in America, and the python takeover from a big report out last month of the Florida Everglades. Huge, huge impact, apparently, on the mammal population there. Michael Dorcas of Davidson College is with us this hour. He was lead author of that paper in the National Academy of Sciences Proceedings, Invasive Pythons as Apex Predator in the Florida Everglades with All Kinds of Consequences. You can join us this hour. What will it finally mean for the python to be the apex predator in Florida? And why did we wait all these years to try and rein this in? We're at 800-423-8255, 800-423-TALK. January 17th, the federal government, this is just last month, after all these years of sales and escape and release, the federal government added Burmese pythons, yellow anacondas, and the northern and southern African pythons to its list of animals that are illegal to import into the U.S. Interior Department Secretary Ken Salazar made the announcement at a press conference in Everglades National Park.
The action that we're taking today is a milestone for us in the protection of the Everglades. We are banning the injurious giant constrictor snakes under the Lacey Act and the authority of the Fish and Wildlife Service. So today, those species that are listed in the notice will be banned from importation into the United States forever.
A little late, 90% plus, latest findings of a whole lot of mammals in that same terrain gone now. The show Python Hunters on the National Geographic Channel followed three snake removal experts. We'll talk to one of our own in just a moment here, but scouring the Everglades for Burmese pythons, or berms as they call them here. In the second season premiered 2010, the hunters find their first big python and pull it out of the marsh by its tail.
All right, I got the head. I know, but he's got this wrap. We're going to have to vacuum through or reach through.
Hold on a second. That's a good size one, guys. Yeah. Can you please just pull him out?
You got it?
Yeah,
I got it.
You got him?
Yeah.
Okay.
They bagged their first berm of the season, but now they'll have to be careful not to get caught themselves.
Guys.
What?
Dude, we're in a...
Hey, that's a gator nest.
There's broken eggshells around here.
Yeah, I'm standing in knee-deep water next to a gator nest.
Hunting pythons in a gator nest. There you got a twofer that I'm not sure many of us would want. Mike Dorcas, lots of people writing in saying, maybe there's a way to do something about this. Carrie says, are pythons good to eat? Maybe there's a market for them, or at least a reward for catching them. And let's get a call from James in Hampton, Virginia, maybe on the same theme. James, you're on the air.
Yes, I watched the Animal Planet, and I've seen a python eat an alligator there, you know. And well, it's a simple solution. Pythons are just like any other snake; they're good to eat. They hunt rattlesnakes. Now, they're much more deadly than python, and pythons are huge. So if they're a great food source, I mean, you could have open season on them, just like deer, or even in the turn of the century. Of last century, there was a population of wolves that they had problems with, and they had a bounty on. So there's several solutions. You know, number one, you know, hunters would love to. I would like to myself really hunt pythons. Be good to eat, and their skins can be used for leather, just like you know, snakeskin boots.
So let's have new boots and a new belt and something on the dinner plate and maybe a little bounty on the side. James, I appreciate your call. Mike Dorcas, what about it? What about bounties and dinner, python burgers, and we're all set?
Right. Well, this is a question I get a lot. So one thing is certainly it's possible to go out and find some pythons like I indicated before, mm-hmm. but pythons are snakes, and snakes are very difficult. It's very difficult to go out into a place and find all the snakes. It's not like birds. It's not like wolves, like he mentioned, and those kind of situations. So you might be able to do that, but the likelihood of really reducing a population using some kind of bounty is unlikely. The other thing that I would say is the tissues of these pythons have been tested for mercury, and because they're feeding so high on the food chain, these things have mercury levels in southern Florida that are higher than anything that's been recorded down there.
Wow.
You definitely do not want to be eating these snakes. Certainly you can make all the boots you want, but I would not recommend recommend eating these animals.
Well, if it's not really good for dinner and you've got to crawl through the deepest Everglades to try and find them, that bounty might have to be pretty high to really get people interested. You know, Michael, if we may, let's talk to somebody who actually goes out and finds them and brings them in. Jeffrey Fobb joins us right now from Homestead, Florida. He's a captain in the Miami-Dade Fire Rescue crew there in the anti-venom unit. Now, of course, pythons are not venomous, but his crew is the one that goes out and brings in pythons when need be. He's also an authorized python removal agent at the Everglades National Park. Jeffrey Fobb, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hello, Tom. How are you doing?
We're pretty well. How often have you gone out and caught a python, Jeffrey?
I haven't gone out to the Everglades since January, but in the last, since December 25th, we've recovered 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, pythons and other of various species.
So you're out there and you're doing it pretty often. Are you catching them when they show up in somebody's backyard pool, or are you out in the undergrowth in the brush looking for them?
A little of both. I'm a person of very little variety in my pursuits.
So sometimes in a pool, do they come into human habitat? Are they a danger to humans?
In the most cases, these are not animals that are going to be dangerous to people because most people are not going to get close enough to them. We find them commonly along the edges of in the rural areas of Miami-Dade County, where they've come in and to feed on livestock or maybe commensal animals, rodents and things that have come in to feed on animal fodder. And we remove them from those areas. We also find them sometimes in residential areas. On December 25th, a 13-foot Burmese python was removed from a neighborhood pool. And then in another neighborhood, about a 10-foot, 3-inch African rock python was removed on the 12th of January.
Wow.
So they do make incursions into residential areas. And actually, we make incursions into natural areas, I think, is
We all have our role in that. I mean, I'm looking at, I'm reading here that a 9 or 10-foot python could be a real danger to a human child. Get up to 15, 16 feet, it could overpower and kill a fully grown adult. But can you picture a situation in which that would happen, Mr. Fobb?
Not really. I mean, even though they're ambush predators, most children just aren't out wandering around on their own. The people who are at risk are the people who are catching them, honestly. And actually, I train people to capture them, you know, with the Nature Conservancy. because it takes more than one group of people to help remove these animals from the environment.
How do you capture a 10, 13, 14, 15-foot python? How do you do it?
You have to have a little confidence and understand the animal's behavior. In most cases, I try to train people to get the animal into kind of a flight mode where it's moving away from them.
Yeah.
And then its attention's not trained on them, and then they can readily pin the head and put it in a bag. The bigger it gets, the more complicated that becomes, of course. And in certain instances, it'd probably be best to have two people to handle the animal.
So pin the head. You've got some kind of long fork or something that you try and pin the head?
I use a snake hook, which is a standard equipment for people who look for snakes. It's just got a kind of a U-shaped end and then a long, it's basically a golf club with a U on the end.
Now I've seen the size of some of these caught in the Everglades. I've seen the photos at our website we've got where there's four or five people holding one of these things. It's so long and looping. And I mean, when you begin to catch them, do they try and then catch you, wrap onto you?
Well, in these circumstances, we're basically acting as the predator, and they will try to defend themselves. Given the opportunity, most of them are more than willing to flee. But unfortunately, we just can't let them go. There's a bit of a struggle. There can be a bit of a struggle for sure.
Do they bite? Do they have teeth?
They will bite, especially, and as soon as you put your hands on them, you're putting yourself in a position where they can and will bite given the opportunity.
Wow. So what are you thinking when you see these numbers that there may be tens of thousands and maybe more in the Everglades? You're talking pretty good numbers there, and that's just a pittance compared to what's out there. Is the python just a permanent part of Florida now, Jeffrey Fobb?
Well, barring any unforeseen circumstance, it probably is. We can control the spread by doing the training of various jurisdictions and organizations on how to successfully remove them. And especially along the edges of where their populations are established, that's important because it can prevent incursions beyond where they're currently known to be and breed.
We hear that rooster behind you there. Now, if I were a python, I might be perking up my ears looking for lunch there.
Yeah, it probably would. I'm actually out cleaning cages right now.
You know, what do you think is going to happen with the profile of animal life in Florida with the apparent very large consumption of mammals that's going on with this big python population?
Well, it's certainly correlated, but there have been changes in the Everglades over the past 20 years that are not associated with the pythons, water flow, tree cover. We've got some new problems where there's some diseases. So that's all going to affect what is a very dynamic environment. And it's really hard to predict what's going to happen. The best we can do is try and limit the impact of any of these factors. And sometimes beyond the scope of just one person or one organization, it takes the work of a lot of people to investigate these things and then figure out ways to, control the damage that they might do.
Wow. Captain Fobb, Jeffrey Fobb with the anti-venom unit in the Miami-Dade Fire Rescue crew there. Captain Fobb, Jeffrey Fobb, thank you very much for being with us today.
Oh, you're very welcome, Tom.
Great to hear from you. Mark in Harvard, Massachusetts. Thanks for calling, Mark. You're on the air.
Hi, Tom. Thanks for taking my call.
Yeah.
I have a question for Michael, or two questions real
okay.
quick.
Yeah.
He said 15 years ago he would not have believed that the pythons could have become resident. I wonder what changed. And the mm-hmm. second question is how far north could they possibly go? The Okefenokee, the Chesapeake Bay Area, there's a lot of salt marshes up there.
Mike Dorcas?
Yeah. Like many people and many scientists, even back in, the 1990s, my perception of large pythons, which, was that they were primarily tropical snakes, and the likelihood of something that large getting established in the continental U.S. was very unlikely.
Because the continental U.S. was not tropical enough in its climate? That was your
feeling? Yeah, for the most part. And it's just one of those things you just hadn't really thought about. And the thing that made me change my mind is that it happened. And, they start turning up in large numbers, and we start finding nests, and we start finding babies, and it becomes very apparent that these things are reproducing. And as the numbers, the numbers that are removed continue to increase, it appears that they're doing very well. So that's what That's what convinced me, is it, that it happened.
And what about Okefenokee and you name it, going on up the
southeast?
Yeah, there have been
several attempts to model essentially risk assessment for other parts of the United States using climate, as we talked about before. And there are various approaches to doing this, but all of the valid climate models show that suitable climate for this species occurs pretty much throughout the entire state of Florida, up the coastal plain of the Carolinas, across the lower coastal plain, of the Gulf states, down into southern Texas. So whether the snakes can actually survive and get that far, we don't know. There are other things that could limit their distribution, and we don't know what kind of time frame we're talking about. But certainly, you know, over the last decade or so, we've seen the population from Everglades National Park expand its range considerably, considerably north of the park itself.
Is there some way to lay down a barrier against their movement, or if the climate allows, they just go? And can they evolve toward a little bit cooler climate as they go?
Yeah, those are some really good questions. We don't know about there's nothing that's been thought of that would really be a good barrier. I mean, you don't want to put a 20-foot wall across the half of the Florida Peninsula. They're pretty, snakes are secretive and they can find ways, through environments, pretty effectively. I can't think of any way to really, prevent that other than like what Jeff was talking about and mm-hmm. doing our best to, intercept them and detect them in new locations and do our best to eradicate them there.
Wow.
But again, that's very difficult to do. These snakes are, you can find some snakes, but you can't find, all the snakes.
And
typically,
that's just grazing at the edges of a very big snake population. I mean, they're a long way from home now. These are snakes native to Bangladesh and Burma, Thailand, Laos, Cambodia, Vietnam. It's a long way to the Everglades. Dave in Berlin, Massachusetts. Dave, you're on the air.
Hi, Tom. Thanks for the call.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm a wildlife biologist, and as a kid studied snakes extensively. I never had a constrictor, but I had a couple questions for your guest, and mm-hmm. one being, is there a way to trap these snakes, in other words, to bring them to us by using some sort of pheromone or bait?
Yeah.
And I know it's a huge area, and I've been down there, and it's so dense that you're right. There's no way you can go to them and be mm-hmm. effective. I'm wondering if we can somehow bring them to us, and I'm wondering if there is an actual market for the skins of the larger snakes. In other words, could we, market that, and is that an exportable item?
A lot of skin on those snakes, and it can be pretty attractive, but what about a way to lure them out? Is there a Pied Piper way, pheromone, bait,
There has been some effort to trap snakes in specific locations, especially on Key Largo, where the Key Largo wood rat is an endangered species and are very concerned. So there's some traps that are set up there. They've captured a few pythons. They're baited traps, so they have a I believe they're baited, or I know they've used baited traps, so they have like a rat in the actual trap to attract pythons. Mm-hmm. The thing is, for the most part, pythons are ambush predators, so they don't crawl around a lot looking for prey, although they may do that to some degree. But typically they pick a spot and they wait for something to come by. So trapping may be effective in some localized places, but that may not work. In terms of using pheromone as an attractant, mm-hmm. That's certainly something that's been discussed among various scientists. But I'm not aware of any research that's going on with pheromones as attractants right now.
So you can't see something that would draw them out in big numbers. They're more likely just to sit in their habitat and wait for that next or last unlucky raccoon or bobcat or deer.
Yeah, it appears that's what they do, for the most part, especially probably the large ones. For example, the one that ate the large deer in October, I believe it was, they found it right along a deer trail. So, apparently it was sitting there waiting for something to come by. And, some snakes will sit there for weeks at a time waiting for a prey item to come by. They can be very patient.
And they don't have to eat very often. There's a lot of them, but sometimes I think they can eat as little as once a year and get by if need be.
Yeah, that's one thing with ectotherms or cold-blooded animals. In many cases, they can take advantage of numerous prey and eat frequently and reproduce and grow rapidly, but they can also go for long periods of time without food. In fact, an adult python that's healthy could probably go well over a year without eating and be just fine.
Michael Dorcas at Davidson College. Please stand by there in North Carolina. We're going right down to Florida again in just a moment. Talk with Deputy Director of the South Florida Natural Resources Center in the Everglades National Park. We're talking about Burmese pythons in America, Burmese pythons taking over the Everglades. You can join us. Will we ever clear them out? Is this just the way it's going to be? 800-423-8255 is our number. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We'll be right back. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. We're talking this hour about Burmese pythons in America and the python takeover of the Florida Everglades, asking as well just how far north they might ultimately go. You can join the conversation this hour. What will it finally mean for the python to be the apex predator in this part of Florida, and will we ever clear them out? 800-423-8255 is our number. 800-423-TALK. And I can't tell you how much I recommend going to our website, onpointradio.org, to see this standoff, a real wrestling match between good-sized python there and a good-sized alligator. This is not a shy, retiring creature, at least not as captured in this particular bit of film. You want to check it out at onpointradio.org. Michael Dorcas is with us. He's lead author of a big paper in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences that found huge decreases just over the last 10 years in all kinds of mammals in the Everglades region. We're talking raccoons and rabbits and fox and deer, and, I mean, even bobcat, alligators even attacked by pythons. But the mammal population in particular, way down. We want to get back into the Everglades right now if we can. Carol Mitchell joins us from Florida. She's Deputy Director of the South Florida Natural Resources Center at the Everglades National Park. Carol Mitchell, it's so good of you to join us. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you, Tom. Thank you for having me.
You spend a lot of time in the Everglades. You're very attuned to the natural profile of that region. Can you just feel and see the change that's been made by the pythons, the absence of all these mammals that were apparently there a decade ago and are now gone, Carol? Can you pick it up in your time around the Everglades?
Well, my own time has been since about 2004, but we do have a number of staff here who have been here for a very long time. And yes, the mammal populations, as Dr. Dorcas's study points out, have decreased since about 2000. That is a problem for the park, for Everglades National Park, because our mission as the National Park Service is to preserve natural habitats and natural components of species for the American public to enjoy.
You know, I was out in the Everglades just, I don't know, a year and a half ago, and it's beautiful. It's otherworldly. I love the Everglades. But just, you know, zipping around there in an airboat in the daytime, you don't see anything. You're not going to see probably a pythons lounging on a big rock, or maybe you do, Carol.
Oh no, actually, for visitors to the park, and actually to any area of the Everglades, because this is a problem that is beyond the borders of Everglades National Park. But
yeah,
for visitors to Everglades National Park, it's very unlikely that you will see a python. Now, the other thing about just wildlife viewing is that there's a very, very seasonal component to that. If you're down here at a time when there's a lot of water in the ecosystem, the wildlife tends to be spread out. Mm-hmm. Whereas at this time of year, when the water is going down and becoming more concentrated, then our birds and our alligators begin to gather around those remaining sources of water, and it's actually a very, very good place to see wildlife. And I do want to emphasize, I guess I'm going to take a little bit of issue with the characterization of a takeover of the Everglades, because whereas this particular species is having a serious effect, and we take that very seriously, you're very unlikely to see one if you're visiting, and you can actually see a huge number of birds and alligators still in Everglades National Park.
Look, we don't want to push people away from the Everglades, but these numbers that Dr. Dorcas found are pretty sobering. 99.3% of raccoons there gone. Opossums, 98.9%. White-tailed deer, a good-sized mammal, 94% gone. And right on down, I mean, We can quibble over the name, but if it's pythons that are largely responsible for those reductions in populations, those are very substantial reductions, Carol.
Yes, they are substantial reductions, and we are taking the problem seriously, and we do have a number of programs in place to address the problem. One thing I do want to point out, and Dr. Dorcas may have some commentary on this as well, is that in general, the emblematic animals in the Everglades that are, you know, very well known are the reptiles and birds. The mammals are an important component of the ecosystem, but in this kind of habitat, the reptiles are alligators, are crocodiles, and birds, all of the beautiful wading birds that the Everglades is known for, are really the visible and more predominant part of our ecosystem and the biomass of animal life here. And those components of the ecosystem are still surviving very well. We have a very, very good diversity of mammals, and we will be, we're addressing the issue of the severe declines in some of those species by research and by control and capture programs as well.
Mike Dorcas, what about pythons and birds? From what I'm reading here from you and others, you're very likely to find a bird in the stomach of a python. I mean, the birds are part of their regular diet as well, are they not?
Right. I mean, the birds, at least from the studies that have been done, make up probably about 25% of the python's diet. But like Carol said, we haven't necessarily seen documented declines in birds. I would like to emphasize what she said. The Everglades is a fantastic place. You're unlikely to see a python. Visitors do encounter them on some occasions, but it's unlikely. And going down there to see the birds and alligators and the other wildlife is something I look forward to every time I get to come down and do research.
Hey, we're all for humans enjoying the Everglades, but we read your paper, and this is a pretty sobering report on the impact of, as you say, tens or hundreds of thousands of pythons.
Well, we don't know how many. Most scientists agree that there are certainly thousands of snakes out there just because of the numbers that we find, and because we know that snakes, in general are very secretive, and also they're occurring over a large landscape that we're not able to sample effectively. But exactly how many, we don't know. That's research that really needs to be done, because it certainly has implications for the impacts they're going to have or are having, and also implications for developing, effective control methods for snakes.
Let's go to Marcy in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Marcy, thanks for calling. You're on the air.
Hi, Tom. Thanks for taking my call.
Mm-hmm.
Well, speaking of control, I'll tell you, I will admit I have a pretty big phobia of snakes, and when I read a New Yorker story several years ago about the python problem in the Everglades, I was horrified, and I've sort of been paying attention ever since. One thing that made me curious when I read that, and I've thought about, I lived in Hawaii for several years, and one thing I liked about Hawaii was the absence of snakes, and I was told that was due to the mongoose population. And I know, the mongoose and, the cobras and things like that, but the mongoose is a predator of snakes. Would not introducing the mongoose to the population, I maybe can't go up against an enormous python, but certainly when they're having these litters of smaller ones, is there any validity to the thought of a mongoose being brought
in? So bring in some kind of predator, maybe that's interesting. I mean, in for a dime, in for a dollar here. I don't share your phobia of snakes, Marcy. I mean, but when it comes to Burmese python, I say bravo in Burma, but maybe not in Florida. Michael Dorcas, in their native habitat in Southeast Asia, is there a predator for these snakes, mongoose or otherwise, that might be that holds the population down there? Could it be introduced to Florida?
That's a good question. We actually know very little about this snake in their native range. There have been anecdotal studies that have been done. There have been a couple of ecological studies, but we know more about pythons in South Florida than we do about pythons in their native range. But certainly you would expect things like crocodiles and other large predators to feed on pythons until they get too large. In terms of introducing another predator to control one predator, In general, our history of introducing one invasive species to control another is not very good. And introducing mongooses, mongoose are not going to prey preferentially on pythons. They would prey on all kinds of other native animals as well. And mongoose have been introduced to many islands, including Hawaii, and in some cases just have devastated some of the local fauna there. So it's probably not a good plan, just because the likelihood that they would severely impact the python population is unknown. And the likelihood that they could severely impact other native species that may not be impacted by pythons, is quite high based on our history with mongoose introductions.
Was there some kind of jackal in Myanmar, Burma, in Southeast Asia that goes after the python?
Not of which I'm aware, necessarily.
Okay. Everybody's dreaming of a magic bullet. Of course, you just go from one darn thing to another once you start introducing invasive species. Bob in Haddam, Connecticut. Bob, you're on the air. Thanks for calling.
Hi, Tom.
Hi.
I'm coming at it from another angle. I'm wondering, in a preventive historical sense, has anyone ever looked into what kind of person decides that they're going to have a python for a pet? And when it gets too big, I'm envisioning people sticking giant snakes in the trunks of their cars and driving to Florida. Is that going on?
And rolling it out into the Everglades. Thank you very much. Yeah, well, let us look at it. Carol, what do you know about the origin of this population? I know there's some debate about it, but what does it seem to be?
Yes, there are probably several sources. One of the really important sources is the pet trade. And the fact that these animals, when it was legal to purchase them here in Florida, were sold in shopping centers for $19.99 as babies. So they're very small, and a lot of people who purchased them were unaware that they were going to grow so big. So
when they
did get big, I'm sure we did have a number of intentional releases of animals who no longer could, was no longer compatible with the pet owner's lifestyle.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
But also, there's some evidence that release can occur when we have a hurricane, for instance, and there is damage or destruction to either breeding facilities or warehouses where these animals that are being traded in the pet trade are kept. And the recent Lacey Act designation that was discussed earlier will help to reduce that for future species. I really think of the python as a poster child. But we have many, many other species out there that potentially can become invasive. And actions such as the Lacey Act and such as recent Florida legislation prohibiting the purchase and possession by private individuals are also helpful in that regard.
Boy, a little late on this one, though. Looking at Facebook here, Lyman writes, how does banning the import of more exotic animals address the issue of those that have gone feral? Good question. Frank writes, I fear it's too late. They're going to be like kudzu and fire ants, Formosan termites, 15-foot snakes everywhere. And Ashwin writes, the U.S. Association of Reptile Keepers has been active in trying to limit the ban on pythons. Ashwin says, this is despicable. These snakes are definitely going to take over the Floridian ecosystem. We're looking at this whole big, ball of snakes here. I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point. Let's go to Richard in Florence, South Carolina. Richard, you're on the air.
I love your show.
Thank you.
And talking about fire ants and kudzu, I'm from South Carolina.
So you know.
Over everything.
Yeah.
A couple of quick questions. Number one, what do they actually do with these things when they catch them? Do they destroy them or put them in zoos? And number two is, with the dramatic decline in their food source, that is the mammals and all, will the food source eventually collapse, leading to a decline of these snakes?
Good questions. Thank you, Richard. Carol, first to you on when they're captured. Now, I know we had on Captain Jeffrey Fobb out of Miami-Dade Fire Rescue. I know from him that he takes a lot of them to a special enclosure where he trains people in how to catch them, because of the security fire department people need to know how to do that. What about when they're captured in the Everglades? Are they killed, Carol?
If pythons are captured in Everglades National Park or on adjacent lands and it's part of our authorized agent program, which Mr. Fobb participates in, those animals are brought into Everglades National Park staff, and the vast majority of them are euthanized and then sent to university for study of diet and body condition and reproduction.
Right.
We have a few are radio tagged and released to either attract in other individuals. It seems as though reproductive females can attract in males, and so we use them as so-called Judas snakes to catch more. And also to just track what they're doing inside the park, how far they go, and where they spend their time.
And Mike, what about this possibility as they sort of decimate or worse the mammal population of a self-limiting python population because there won't be that same diet of opossums and raccoons and even deer?
Yeah, that's a really good question, one we actually pose in our paper that we don't necessarily know the answer to. I mean, typically when new species, especially predators, are introduced or removed from ecosystems, there are new equilibriums that are reached between predators and prey. And exactly what that will be or what that will look like, we don't know. Of course, it's complicated by the fact that, you know, pythons don't eat just mammals. They can eat birds and other things as well. And so we don't know you certainly would predict that at some point it would result in reduction of the python population, but and then that would allow prey populations to increase back, you know, to some level.
Well, you know, it's frustrating, Michael, that more action wasn't taken sooner on this. I mean, our listener notes, and we see it in my reading here, that there was very heavy lobbying not to restrict the trade in these snakes. But now they've taken over. Carol, you know, wants to argue with that characterization, but they are very, very heavily populating and impacting a real national treasure there. I mean, it seems odd that a bunch of snake retailers could sort of drive our ecosystem's fate here back in the day when it was just open season to sell, Mike.
Yeah, well, I mean, they've got a pretty powerful agenda, and that's what they use to make money. And so they've been, you know, there have been a few of them that have been extremely vocal and have actually persuaded Congress, you know, to actually remove some of the species that were originally going to be on the injurious species listing, such as green anacondas and reticulated pythons.
They get those taken off. Carol, you know, it's millions of years since native big snakes like these lived in your neck of the woods. Now they're there in their thousands, maybe tens or hundreds of thousands. Do you think we'll one day just come to accept this? Maybe on your Park Service badge in the Everglades you'll have an alligator and a flamingo and a Burmese python?
No, I don't think that latter is likely to happen. I think that they are probably going to be a feature of this ecosystem for a very long time. The efforts that we are making to capture, do research, educate, and make changes to policy, I think will suppress the population. But I just wanted to mention that the three people that you had on the phone today were just the tip of the iceberg of a very, very active group of agencies and private individuals and NGOs who are really working on this problem locally here in the Everglades.
A lot of people working on it and up against a whole lot of snakes. Carol Mitchell, Deputy Director of the South Florida Natural Resources Center at the Everglades National Park. Carol, thank you so much for being with us today from Florida.
My pleasure.
And Michael Dorcas, professor of biology at Davidson College, co-author of Invasive Pythons in the United States, Ecology of an Introduced Predator. Mike Dorcas, thanks so much.
You bet. Thank you.
I'm Tom Ashbrook. This is On Point.